Yo, what's up, man? I said no more auditions, man. Stupid.
Sorry, man. Auditions are over today, all right? You got to come back next week. Maybe we can work something out, all right? Box.
You're now listening to the legendary Royal Esquire.
Royal Esquire.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Vinyl Esquire.
Rock the beat with your hand. Vinyl Esquire. Culture, truth, music.
Vinyl Esquire. Vinyl
Ladies
Esquire.
And gentlemen, are you ready for LL Cool J and Cut Creator? But ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, we will have for you Mr. LL Cool J and Cut Creator.
Vinyl Esquire.
Ladies and gentlemen, and I got my man Cut Creator. Now what you're about to see right now is known as rapping and scratching. For those of you who don't know, there must be some out there. How many of y'all saw this before?
Hello world, I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire, the podcast that delivers culture, truth, music. Would you join me, please, in welcoming DJ Rip?
Hello, world. I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire. And my name is DJ Rip. And Vinyl Esquire is the DJ podcast where we uplift the DJ culture and honor our legends. And without further ado, I want to introduce the legendary DJ, the legendary turntablist. I want to introduce to Vinyl Esquire, the legendary DJ Cut Creator.
What good? What's good? What's good?
Yo, Cut Creator, how you doing, man?
I'm all right, man. I'm all right.
Well, it's a pleasure to talk with you, and thank you for coming on Vinyl Esquire.
Cool. I appreciate it.
Well, man, I start every interview the same way. Let me go ahead and peel them layers back and get right into it. So, Cut Creator, can you tell me what or who made you want to be a DJ?
Well, it's funny, man, because I grew up in the funk era, man. I love funk, the Ohio Players and all that stuff. So, in junior high school, I took up trombone and baritone and stuff like that. But in that era, it wasn't like the cool thing. You know what I mean? You know, it really wasn't the cool thing. So I got out of that a little bit and got more so into the turntable thing, you know, the block parties and seeing how fun that was. And that's how I really started, watching some neighborhood cats, you know, DJ. And that's how I really got started.
So what year would you say that was?
Oh, man, I would say 1977.
So was there one particular inspiration or one particular person, or were you just seeing what was going on? And we're talking about Queens at this time, right?
Yeah. I'll tell you what, man. A guy that really helped me out, man, inspired me back in the day was a guy by the name of DJ Divine from a group called Infinity Machine. They don't get a lot of credit. You know, we hear a lot of stuff, you know, about from the Bronx and say uptown. But Divine was our, like, Cool Herc, per se.
And this was in 1977-ish in Queens, yes?
Yes, yes, yes.
And what part of Queens?
South Side, Jamaica, St. Albans, Hollis.
Got you. Okay, go on.
Yeah, so that's what we, because to be honest, man, only one really we heard of outside of Queens was like Hollywood. We, be honest, we didn't even hear of Cool Herc. A lot of us never heard of Cool Herc. We heard of Flash, of course.
Okay.
And DJ Hollywood. Those were the guys that we heard about. We didn't hear about too many of them other guys.
Wow, okay.
To be honest, I mean.
Gotcha. So you say that you started as a DJ professionally in 1977, right?
I started in 77. I say professionally, it would have been more like 82.
Got you. So talk to me about what happened, you know, from 77 to 82.
Right then and there is pretty much perfecting the craft. Perfecting the craft, also building a sound system. See, in Queens, in Brooklyn, we all had major sound systems.
Right, right.
Sarah Vegas. Sometimes we would build speakers and, you know, buy the top-notch woofers, the Gauss and, you know, the big, you know, heavy thumpers, man. Back then, I was perfecting it, doing a lot of block parties, a lot of school parties. And around 82, 83, I met up with a young gentleman by the name of Todd Smith, who was probably around, I guess he was maybe like 12, 13 years old. And that's how we linked up. And when he got his deal, originally, I became his DJ.
Okay, so hold on. Let's, before we get to Todd Smith, so, you know, we're talking about LL Cool J. You're talking about a young LL Cool J, 12, 13. Let's talk about Cut Create a little bit more. What was your first DJ name?
Cool J.
So your first DJ name was DJ Cool J.
Right.
Wow. Okay. That's interesting. DJ Cool J, and you end up DJing for LL Cool J later.
Right. My first name is Jay, J-A-Y.
Got you. Okay, so we're talking about the legendary DJ Cut Creator. By the way, to me, you always had one of the most incredible DJ names.
Well, I got to say this, man.
Yep.
A lot of people don't realize something. I was not the original Cut Creator.
Okay. Talk to me about that.
I was not the original Cut Creator. And a lot of people, few people know, there was a guy by the name of Philip that was going by the name of Cut Creator. He did one show when LL got his deal. He did one show with us because we used two DJs. It was me and him.
Wow, okay.
So after the first show, it just didn't click with him. You know, he was more of a, in all due respect, he was a good DJ. But he in front of, as far as performing, he wasn't good at performing.
Okay.
You know, he was a good DJ, and I'm not knocking him, you know. And after that, I just, the conflict with Cool J, the name Cool J was a problem. You know, because LL was a soloist. And so to make, you know, I took over the name Cut Creator. And this was happening about 1984.
Okay. So let's break this down a little bit. So you started DJing in 77, but professionally you say about 82. Your first DJ name was DJ Cool J. So so now talk to me just a little bit about the LL Cool J interaction, that very first, you know, when you guys met. Were you a rap group? Was he always a solo MC with DJs? How did the two DJ thing kind of paint the picture of that very first,
okay,
those first days?
I'm actually leaving a little bit out. In between 77 and 81, 82, I actually was really athletic. I got scholarships. I was I wrestled.
Okay.
I actually wrestled. I was New York City champ, New York State runner up. I got scholarships in Syracuse, all kind of schools.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So I was pretty good. So a lot of that time in between, I was kind of in my schooling, you know, in training. So when I kind of just stopped with it, you know, as far as, you know, if it was baseball or basketball, I would have stuck with it. But, you know, wrestling is not a real, it's not a sport where, you know, you can go to the pros per se.
Right, right.
So when I started coming back DJing, doing these parties, I never forget, it was a young, like I said, young 12, 13 year old. And he said, yo, man, let me rap. He always used to ask me to rap. I'm like, man, get out of here, man. You know, so one time it was like one party that, you know, everybody was just doing their own thing. So I let him rap and we were like amazed at his ability at that age, his words, metaphors, everything, his style. At 12 and 13 years old, man, he was killing people.
Right, right.
So after that, I would just bring him around to parties and stuff when we used to do the battles and stuff, and he would kill.
Wow, okay. So you were still, at that time, DJ Cool J. What was his first rap name?
He was LL Cool J.
Okay, okay. So the demos. How did you guys become, you know, how did you go from playing in the parties, house parties, and him getting on the mic to recording records and becoming an entity?
Well, that's real interesting because, you know, I didn't really take it serious like that. You know, I'm looking for jobs. You know what I mean?
Right.
I just left school. So I didn't take it serious. I was doing it. You know, it wasn't paying my bills. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
So what I did was, you know, I did my daily living. But he was the one that was shopping his deal around. I mean, he was shopping till it got in the hands of Rick Rubin. And he brought me up there because originally, I wasn't going to DJ for him. I was going to be his road manager, you know, because I was a business type of, you know, I was business. So originally, I was going to be the road manager. I didn't have nothing. I wasn't thinking about DJing. You know, I was just kind of, because I always overprotected him. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. Are you a little older than him?
Yes, yes.
Okay, gotcha.
I think about 5 years, 5 or 6 years old, out of something like that.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
So, I always protected him. His mother trusted me. His grandmother trusted me. So, originally, I was just coming, you know, to road manager him for a few gigs. You know, I applied for corrections and all that. You know, and in New York, it takes a while. It's not like, you know, down in Atlanta where I'm at now, but it takes a while.
Right.
So that came out, just going to, you know, I was going to roll with it. You know, I didn't think it would end up the way it ended up, you know.
Absolutely. So he started making his own demos at his house. He's shopping it to record labels. And Rick Rubin decides to pick up the young LL Cool J. And Cut Creator, you're not his actual DJ, or you didn't plan on being the DJ at that time. You plan on being a road manager, right? So
absolutely.
So how did this change? What changed?
That first gig, I'll never forget, it was a gig we did at Boys and Girls High School in Brooklyn. And we played, I'll never forget, with Divine Sounds group, What People Do for Money. And see, me and LL had routines already for years.
Okay.
So we knew, I mean, I consider myself the best at being a musical director.
Okay.
In hip hop, not just a DJ, a musical director. And I learned that watching and studying the late great Jam Master Jay.
Absolutely.
How to be in control, timing, and all that. So me and LL had a good chemistry already.
Okay.
And the other guy, Philip, he really, like I said, he was a good DJ, very good DJ. I'm not knocking him. He just didn't have that chemistry with LL.
Got you.
And that's where it really clicked. And then, like I said, I was a big brother figure to him anyway. And like his mom and grandma trusted me around him. You know, I wouldn't let him go too crazy.
Right.
You know what I mean? And then, you know, because I would report to them and you know, let them know and everything, you know, what's going on. And they appreciated that.
So that's very interesting that LL had, you know, and this interview is about Cut Creator, not LL. But, you know, it's definitely, you know, a big part of your career. But that's interesting that LL had two DJs in the very beginning, because later on he adapts two DJs on the second album, right? So,
right. So
talk to me about the music now at this point. You said you guys had that first gig and that changed everything. Go ahead and elaborate a little bit on that.
Well, we had routines because, you know, if you're being booked for a show, you need, you need a show. That's where, to me right now, I'm not trying to jump forward. A lot of people don't understand in this business what a show is, you know.
Oh, I totally agree and understand. Exactly what you're saying.
We put a show together. We might have 20 minutes worth of routines, and then you do your one song or your two songs, whatever you have, and you keep it moving, you know.
Right, absolutely.
You know, so we have routines and, you know, stuff like with songs like Love is a Message or something like that. I don't even remember. That's how long ago it was.
Right, of course. Right.
But we would have routines to make, you know, the show fulfill the whole show.
Absolutely.
But we perfected it, and we did it so long, it was like nothing, you know, even right now. I mean, I haven't did anything with him in a minute, but, you know, it's easy. It's like 1, 2, 3 for me.
Right, absolutely. How did you end up becoming Cut Creator, LL Cool J's DJ, and getting into some of these classic records that came out on that first album? How did the transition happen?
Well, like I said, it goes back to that first performance. You know, the other DJ really, when it came to that lane, he wasn't that good in that lane.
Okay.
Performing-wise, in the performance-wise. So, and then me and LL just clicked. It was just a click that just happened, you know.
Right.
It was, yeah, that's how it really happened. It was just, they didn't click on stage. Me and LL clicked on stage. And I think the other guy, he was doing something else. He wasn't really into it 100% anyway.
Got it. Okay. So let's talk about the records. Because again, we're talking about, you know, 83, 84. You're talking about him getting the deal with Rick and Def Jam. Well, them creating Def Jam and putting out LL Cool J as their first major, you know, artist and their first input into hip hop, right? So now, you know, it's what, not like 1985 now, and the first album comes out, it's titled Radio. So you have these singles and these songs, and now here's Cut Creator. How did the creation of the records and your participation in the cuts and the scratching, and how did that morph together?
Well, the first album really, to be totally honest, didn't have a lot to do with me because it was already in, it was already in production, per se.
Okay.
You know, it was already in production. You had Jazzy J, Rick Rubin, even the other guy, Philip, did some stuff, you know. So I wasn't involved with that. It was after that I started getting involved a little bit more.
Really?
Yeah.
So can we talk about
Rock the Bells. I mean, this is probably the most cut, scratched, DJ-friendly, iconic record, you know, in hip-hop history, Rock the Bells. And LL highlighted you a lot on that particular record, you know, and future records, which, you know, he should have. You were his DJ. Talk to me about Rock the Bells. Did you have any participation in that particular record?
Believe it or not, that was a Rick Rubin classic. That was a Rick Rubin classic. I think Rock the Bells was a song where, to be honest with you, and I'm not going to honeycoat it, where hip-hop really appreciated the DJ a little bit more.
Right.
I think when hip-hop, when the DJ was really, a little bit beforehand, was hip-hop, and then the MC was behind the DJ. You understand where I'm coming from?
Absolutely.
That's when, like, nowadays, man, you know, I've honestly seen people with no DJs, you know.
Right.
But that's where that came about. And, of course, you know, the legends, Run DMC, you know, they always contributed to Jam Master Jay and Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. They always show love
to the DJ. Right.
Yeah, and you know, on and on and on and on, you know. So pretty much that's how that came about, the dedication, you know, to the DJ, you know. What's my DJ's name? Cut Creator.
Right.
So that was kind of getting me out there too, you know. And even beforehand, it was radio.
Right.
You know, where to expand my musical, man, Cut Creator, rock the beat with your hand, you know.
Right.
I was, you know, you would always get those, you know, I would always get those plug and those songs, you know, which I couldn't imagine them being back then. These were going to be still playing 30 something years later, you know.
Absolutely. So when those particular opportunities came up, were you the one in the studio, you know, with the sounds and the breaks and, you know, doing
it? I contribute it. See, a lot of people think it was one person. It's a contribute to, you know, a few of us.
Okay.
Rick. Yeah, Rick, LL. Even LL did some scratching on some stuff, you know?
Wow.
So it was
okay.
Like, yeah, try this. Let's do this. All right, that's good. Leave it alone. Let it be, you know?
Gotcha.
It was more creative than just one person, you know? There was sometimes, like, even fast-forwarding a little bit, the next album when Bobcat came in, you know, I would do some stuff. He would do some stuff.
Okay, hold on. I don't want to get there yet. We're getting to that. But we're getting to that. So you're saying that, you know, like, you know, there was a collaborative effort with that radio album with Rick Rubin, Jazzy J, yourself participating in providing cuts and scratches and sound effects for that particular
right.
album, correct?
Yeah, it was a team effort. It wasn't like a one man thing.
Got you. Just like Run DMC and Grandmaster Flash and Furious Five, like yourself. Like you said earlier, excuse me, you know, the DJ was always highlighted in the early days of hip hop. And you know, later on in the 90s, you know, in the late 90s, you know, the DJ wasn't as prevalent on the records doing the scratching and the cutting like it was in the 80s. Right. So that's why, I brought, you know, that up, that, you know, those particular records, you know, Rock the Bells and Radio, I Need a Beat, the way Cut Creator was put on the forefront was always amazing to me, right? And mm-hmm. Yeah, and yes, that goes into the second album when they decided to name a song after you, Go Cut Creator Go, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Talk about that particular concept and that, because prior to that, I never knew that LL had two DJs. It was always Cut Creator. It was you as the DJ, highlighted as the DJ. It was LL and it was E-Love, right? It was three of right. y'all, right?
Right.
So talk to me about the second album, Bigger and Deffer. He incorporates DJ Bobcat, the legendary West Coast, you know, he's my brother and you know, I love Bobcat. And so Bobcat was a part of LA Posse, which was a part of the production team that put together Bigger and Deffer, correct? So
absolutely.
So talk to me about now he's incorporating Bobcat as a secondary visual DJ. Talk to me about that, you know, that whole process and how that happened, especially bringing in the single, one of the singles off the album, Go Cut Creator Go, which is named after you.
And that was a weird, it was weird in the beginning, man. It really was weird in the beginning because I didn't know Daryl and Muffler and Bob. I didn't know them. I did know some of Roger Clayton and those cats from Uncle Jam's Army out there.
Right.
I did know them. I did know them. I didn't know Daryl, Bob, and Dwayne. Muffler, we call him Muffler.
Okay.
But, you know, me and Bob was like still like my little brother. And he brought an element that was amazing. I'm not going to sit here and lie. You know, he was a good young producer. And his energy, his DJing skills, he had a different flavor. I had one type of flavor. He had a different type of flavor. And then when we did things in the studio or in live shows, it just clicked. It honestly just clicked.
Got you. Okay.
You know, like I said, I was the main course. No, I don't even say main course. I was the chicken. He was the spice.
Okay. Got you.
And what I mean by that, I had the main, I don't even know the words I'm trying to use, but the music. And he would add on. So it was actually really cool. So then when he added on, I could add on behind him. It would make it like a band, per se.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So again, another collaborative effort. So instead of Rick Rubin and Jazzy J, you know, and the older East Coast flavor, now you have a West Coast flavor coming in and, you know, a little bit more beat break sampling and whatnot. So
right.
Another collaborative effort, which made another classic album bigger and deafer.
Right.
Which spawned, you know, the classic singles. You know, I Need Love, I'm Bad, and Go Cut Creator Go, no question. So the incredible thing about that particular album, you know, is again, your involvement, you know, the album covers, the videos. Talk to me about, you know, how the whole touring and that experience was going on, because now you got a second album, which is now a smash, and you're all over the world. Talk to me about how that experience was, you know, at that time.
I'll tell you what really busted out. Rewind it a little bit. The things that really, really made it take off was the movie Crush Groove.
Right, right. Absolutely.
The visual of Crush Groove. Once that hit, I kid you not, I'm on the subway going to the premiere. I didn't know, I'll be honest with you, I didn't know how big it was or how big it was going to be.
Really?
We were doing little shows I kid you not, we were doing shows on tabletops for like $300-$400. Then all of a sudden, the shows became $1,000, $2,000. Then we're in Philly doing 4 or 5 shows a night. You know, I'll tell you a true story. I remember the day my son was born, my oldest son, we did 4 shows that day.
Wow.
Four shows, starting at 7 o'clock and the last one at 4 o'clock in the morning. And wow. That's how crazy it was. So going back, fast forwarding back, you know, of course, the first album, there were no videos.
Right.
Then, you know, the Crush Groove was our video, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it was an iconic scene. He comes right in that room with the radio. You are holding the radio.
Yes.
And he says, Box. Classic.
That was our video off the first album, to be honest with you.
Right, right. Absolutely.
And then fast forwarded, then, you know, we did the video with I'm Bad. And it's funny, at the same time, remember Michael Jackson had the song I'm Bad out.
Absolutely.
So that was fun. That was fun. You know, there was always pictures with LL and Michael Jackson on Right On Magazine, Word Up Magazine. That's when magazine, you know, before the social media days.
Right.
When magazines, man, you had to, you know, I want to see what's going on. You know, that was our communication, you know. It might have been late, but, you know, magazines, we, you know, Right On, Word Up. I forgot the other magazine we used to read.
Well, the Source came out a little later.
Yeah, Source and Vibe a little bit later.
Right, like right, right.
90s.
So
it was Word Up, Right On, and, you know, magazines like that.
Rap Pages, maybe?
Something like that. You know.
Yeah, something. Right, right, right. So and then, of course, Yo MTV Raps explodes, and, you know, now you're all over the box.
But be honest with you, that was even further down.
Yeah, you're right.
That was even further down than that. It was touring. It was shows. And one good thing about, I can't even tell you the last actual rap tour that I've been on, like a real tour. But shows were important too. Very important.
Absolutely.
Because remember, in 86, off the first album, we did the Raising Hell tour.
Right, right.
You know, we did some, before then we did a couple of dates on the Fresh Fest, but we did the Raising Hell tour.
Yep.
And that was 8 months of straight touring. That was not like no joke. It was 8 months of straight touring. Like, we went to cities 2 and 3 times.
See, and I know that changed your life completely because again, you know, that's the time frame where you can put out an album and tour for 2-3 years. you know, and then you put out the next album, because Radio came out in 85 and then Bigger and Deafer is 87, 88, right?
So yeah, 87, yeah.
Yeah, 87. So that's a 2-year time frame where you're just touring, correct?
Yeah, touring, doing shows, and then take about 3-4 months and start recording again.
Right, and then 87, here comes Bigger and Deafer. And so, so again, that Bigger and Deafer album, I would assume, took you straight through the rest of the 80s, and you know, and then, you know, here comes album number 3. So I'm assuming that touring kept Cut Creator busy in the late 80s and early 90s.
Oh, yeah, because now you go to 87, you go 87, you go on a Bigger, we go on a Bigger and Deafer tour. We're headlining now. You know, before it was Run DMC headlining.
Right.
Now, from 86 to 87, now you're headlining. We're headlining with Houdini, Public Enemy. We're introducing Public Enemy out there.
Right.
Who else was on that show? Timex Social Club. Timex Social Club was Raising Hell. Who was on this tour? Oh, we had Kool Moe Dee on this. Sometimes we had Eric B. Rakim. Sometimes Fresh Prince, you know, Jazzy Jeff from Fresh Prince. So though that came right after. So those were the days when, you know, you toured. We did another 6 months off of that tour.
Right, right.
You know.
So what was your what was your relationship, you know, back to you as a DJ? What was your relationship with, you know, Russell Simmons and Rick Rubin and, you know, Jazzy J, you know, and Run DMC, you know, for that matter? What was your relationship like with some of those? I know some of those, you know, guys are named from Queens, right? But
yeah.
But you being Cut Creator, LL Cool J's DJ, and you're bigger than life now at this point. What was your relationship in hip-hop as a DJ with some of your counterparts?
Well, this is funny, man. I worked at Rush Productions when it was 5 people in the office, a little bitty office. I worked in the office. I was, I guess, what they call an office boy.
Wow.
You know, I ran errands. Yeah, I ran errands and got supplies and did all that. It was myself, Russell, Heidi Smith, Tony Rome, Bill Adler. That was it. Before Lee Alcorn, before everybody. You know, I was an office boy at Rush Productions.
Was that because you were associated with LL?
Yeah.
Okay, got you.
Yeah, I mean, then fast forward, I knew Jam Master Jay, Hurricane, Davey DMX. I knew those cats from Queens.
Right.
I didn't really know Run. Didn't really know DMC.
Got you.
You know, but I knew the, you know, those cats.
I mean, I guess it kind of makes sense from the DJ perspective, right?
Yeah.
So how did you, through the whole process, right, even though it was a collaborative effort, it sounded like, with the production and the DJ direction on all of LL's albums, how did you approach, you personally, how did you approach any of the records, you know, from the cuts, the scratching, the samples, how did you approach some of the recordings?
You just got to study it and see. Now, you got to remember something. This was way prior to Serato.
Of course.
So you would have to go and find rubs and see. Now, if I had the chance to do it, I would build different stuff. You know, I would build them, you know, through the computer, sound, you know.
Right.
Different rubs, stabs, and all that. You can build them, make them beefier. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Instead of going, yeah. But you just had to search, man. I always had records. I always had go through B-sides. You know, I always listen to B-sides, breaks, everything. You know, you just had to study, man. It wasn't no getting around it. Like today's time, it would have been so much easier. You know, guys are making albums in 2 days now, man.
Right,
you know,
right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So now it's real easy. But back then you had to go through records and, oh, that's a crazy stab, or, you know, the horn stabs and stuff like that. You know, I would go through like orchestra classicals, you know, records to hear, you know, stabs and rubs and whatever. So that's what really happened.
Got it. So what kept Cut Creator busy through the 90s, you know, the late 90s and early 2000s? I mean, you know, was it touring with LL, or was there other projects that we don't know about? What kept you busy throughout the years?
Pretty much touring. We could do 10, 15 shows a year, and it'll be beneficial, you know. But I also was going back to school a little bit, doing some other things, opening up a business, you know.
Okay.
Because I knew, especially going into the 90s, like 92, 93, with music changing, with the Biggies, the Pacs, and all that.
Right.
I'm like, yeah, I just thought it was a matter of time, you know, before, you know, our time ran out.
Really? Okay.
So, yeah. So I actually worked for the Federal Reserve. I was supervising money transport. Like, I would transport millions of dollars a day, you know.
Wow.
So I've done 9 to 5 in between. You know,
so this was around, you know, so this was probably what, I don't want to say music slowed down for LL or for you, but I know LL started getting into movies and films and kind of stepped away a little bit from the music. Is that what kind of slowed down the music for you and got you into doing other things other than music?
Yeah. I mean, I was a reality, you know, but every time it seemed like it slowed down, it picked back up. I will say one thing about LL, man. He might fall down, or I won't say fall down, but he might, like, an album might come out and people might not really feel it.
Right, right. Understood.
But he'll regroup himself and come back with a classic.
Right.
You know, like, prime example, to me, I thought it was a good album, 14 Shots to the Dome.
I did, too. I liked the record, too.
If it wasn't the right album for that time, because there was a classic, I to this day, I'm like, people don't even understand it. Like, one of the songs on it was Crossroads. You know, if you really listen to it, it's crazy. The production on it, it was crazy with orchestra and everything.
Right.
So, but it wasn't the right album for that time, you know. So he comes back and he does a Mr. Smith album. You know, he comes back with something like that with classics, doing it. Mama Said Knock You Out, you know, Jangling Baby and all.
Right, so right.
That's how he always rebound from those situations. I mean, what is it, 13, 14 albums? You know, everything can't be a major hit, but he had a good run. At least 11 of those were classics, you know?
Right, right. Yeah, I mean, I never really felt like LL Cool J fell off. You know, I just felt like he went different directions and, you know, and you're acting and, you know, you're doing a lot of different things other than the music. You're focusing on other things than the music. So I just felt like, you know, some things were better than others. But I think his longevity is incredible and it's unparalleled, you know. And you know, so was there a time when, you know, you would be, you know, you said maybe working a day job or you was working a job and still DJing? And, like, would you be working and then go on the road and go do a tour with LL or?
Yeah, actually, yeah.
Wow, okay.
It was funny. Hey, I mean, it would be cool. Like, you know, I remember one time we were doing shows with Lynyrd Skynyrd, man. We were doing shows with Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Right.
Like, not once, but two shows, three shows, festivals. I'm like, this is crazy, you know?
Right, right.
And I, you know, we did so many shows, it's unreal. So, and then there was a point where Bobcat left, I felt it was real important for me to stay with him because I was that I was the one to keep it real, like, yo, dude, that's an ugly ass shirt, you know what I mean? You know,
right.
Instead of, oh man, that's a beautiful shirt, you know people will get around you and do all that.
Yeah, you weren't a yes man. You were one of the
exactly.
One of the original people around him that he could respect and could, you know, keep the balance, right?
Yeah. And I mean, we could discuss, like, you, like, I said, yo, man, that's an ugly shirt. And he'd be like, man, so tell me, why is it ugly? You know what I mean?
It's just right.
It's a fair discussion.
Right, absolutely. So there was obviously a time when, you know, you weren't working with LL and then you were. So from a DJ perspective, how have you kept your longevity going over all these years? What has kept you busy as a DJ?
Really, man, I've been touring myself. I consider myself, in this day and time, like, I consider myself a party rocker. In the kind of a Hollywood Kid Capri, you know, rocking parties, people dancing, screaming, having a good time. So that always wins with me as far as, you know, just touring and doing things on my own.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I work with Tom Joyner. I do all Tom Joyner's stuff. I do great radio. You know, I was went to Houston and did radio. Had my own radio show, you know, 6 days a week. Did mixes for other stations. Plus, I was, you know, end up being a music director for a radio station in a major market. Things like that kept me busy.
Absolutely. I didn't even know you had I mean, I had heard about Tom Joyner and whatnot, but I didn't know you had that many radio gigs. I mean, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
So that's dope, too. So
yeah, I was with Cumulus Broadcasting.
Got you. So what projects are you working on right now?
Believe it or not, man, I'm a restaurateur. Own a restaurant here in Atlanta.
Oh, nice. What's the name of the restaurant?
Yeah, Breeze Pork Bar and Grill.
Very nice.
You know, specializes in soul food, seafood, and kind of Caribbean. I'm still DJing. I'm just the same thing, man. Living day by day and just enjoying life, man. Love playing, man. Love DJing.
Absolutely. But that's incredible. So, you know, the legendary DJ Cut Creator is now a business restaurant owner and DJing when you want, how you want, right? I mean, that's absolutely incredible. Before we get out of here, Cut, can you give me, from the DJ's perspective, can you give me one story from your history that our listeners may not know? Just give me one incredible experience that you remember in your past being DJ Cut Creator. I know there might be a lot of them, but just give me one.
There's a lot. I guess one story that really kind of, one story that was awesome to me, and this was kind of recently.
Okay.
A few years back. I was in Miami. We were going on the Tom Joyner cruise. So we're sitting at a table. I'm sitting there with like 10 people. And I'm sitting there, and it's Roy Ayers, it's Mickey Howard, it's the Jazz Crusaders, there was Lonnie Liston Smith, and someone else. It was a legend. And I'm sitting here, and I'm like, wait a minute, I'm sitting here eating breakfast with people I stay samples, and,
you know,
it was the weirdest, and it was like, I almost started tearing up, because they're telling their sewer stories, and I'm like, wow. That's Roy Ayers, you know, run, you know,
right.
Mickey Howard, you know, Lonnie Liston Smith, you know, and that was it was like, wow, I'm here. And then somebody said something, and they said, I said, hey, I'm on Cut Creator. And they said, I know you, you know, and I'm like, wow, that was deep for me.
Wow. Yeah, that's incredible. That sounded like it was a great experience.
Oh, yeah. I mean, because, you know, believe it or not, and we credit the rappers, but we credit the DJs too, because our samples, the stuff we play. Remember, we bring a lot of these people back from the dead, per se. Not dead literally, but their music back.
Absolutely.
You know, Run DMC brought back Aerosmith.
Absolutely.
You know, so a lot of people, you know, when they sample and use your stuff or whatever, we're bringing them back to life.
Absolutely. I mean, it's no question. And, you know, we talk about, you know, the records that you're a part of, you know, when you're talking about Rock the Bells and, you know, sampling the Go-Go and, you know, and a lot of the samples, you know, I'm Bad sampling, you know, Shaft and, you know what I mean? Like all of these particular records and like Go Cut Creator Go with the guitars and all of those samples, you know, that's why hip hop was incredible. And it's great because it took everything and put it all together. And you take old records that, you know, may have came out in the 60s that people don't even remember. Some were hits, some were not. But if you could recreate records and make hits again 30 years later for people that weren't even alive when they came out, it's incredible.
You know, the funny part with that is, man, Rip, if we had technology
back then,
like we had it back then.
Right.
Oh, my goodness, man.
So
that. But the reason why I say this. I feel, and this might be not trying to downgrade or anybody, but it seems like the technology makes people a little less hungrier.
Absolutely.
I guess, is that the right way of saying it? A little less.
Well, creative, I think
a little less creative.
You get a little lazy because it's all in front of you and you don't, you don't have to search. Now, again, you know, to me, and I don't mean to cut you off. I'm so sorry, but to me, it's like the internet is the gift and the curse. It's everything that you want and everything that you don't need, right? So it's also the same thing with technology, which is the internet. But technology, the new drum machines and the new controllers and all of this is Serato. It's amazing. It's great because it gives us everything that's right in front of us at a fingertip. But the backside to that, or the gift and the curse to that, to me, is that if you never learned how to search and be creative and make things that weren't there, to me, it stifles your creativity because you don't really know how to do it, right? Like, it's there. But like when you're talking about having samplers back in the 80s that you could only sample 4 seconds, you had to figure out how to stretch it and figure out how to use it. and all of those things. And then, you know, you couldn't play things, so you had to find them on the, if I wanted a guitar, you know, riff or a piano, I'd have to go find the record and search and search and then find it, right?
Yeah, because remember, a lot of, when you search, a lot of those records are out of key like a son of a gun.
Right, right.
They're out of key like, you know, they're out of key, man. But, yeah, you did that. Like, if I took my laptop right now, you know, between that and Reasons and Recycle and, you know, even like a Fruity Loops, which I've never used, but those programs alone, I mean, and then, you know, what's the one with, that has all the loops and stuff? Man, you can make stuff right off the rip, you know. You get your plugins. You don't even have to, I mean, literally in 30 minutes, you know.
Absolutely. And it's just interesting how records that came out in the 70s. Okay, let's not talk about the 70s, because those were the original bands, you know, and all of that. Because even the rap records that came out in the late 70s were replays of R&B records, right? Let's talk about the 80s when we were sampling and using drum machines and samplers, right? Mm-hmm. Even those records, your records, still can stand the test of time, and you can play them today and they still rock, right? I mean, so the jury is still out if a record that came out today is going to last 30 years.
Well, I always say that, Rip. I say that, and I'm not knocking nobody in this era. But everybody I know, or everybody in my era, had a hit. What I mean, a hit that's like, prime example, look at somebody like Special Ed. Once, you know, I Got It Made.
Right, right.
Classic. I should say a classic, not a hit, a classic.
Correct.
Even everybody had a classic, at least one.
Yeah. A hit now, record and a classic, I mean, is two different things. You're right.
Nowadays, like, the songs are going by so quick, they're putting them out so quick. Like, you know, I'll get, you know, once every Monday or maybe every two Mondays, I do my new music stuff, see what's hot, what's playing. I don't really do too much, add it in my Serato, you know, my crates. But, you know, there's some stuff you got to put in. And, you know, you start playing it, and two weeks later, it's not the hot song no more.
Right. Absolutely.
You know, when you used to have to go into the studio and being there 10, 12 hours a day, you would appreciate the songs, you know, to be, they weren't coming out as fast.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, there's a lot of good music that's out there right now, and you know, but there's nothing like the classics, you know. So, you know, salute everybody that's doing their thing now, but I salute you to the utmost, and LL and Bobcat and all of the legends. I just thank God that you all made the records that you made so we can play them and appreciate them now. And that's the reason why I'm on the phone with you now, interviewing you for Vinyl Esquire. Because of the music and the legacy that Cut Creator, you know, made on hip hop. I mean, it just is what it is. And for DJs, we always used to cut those records and play all that music. So thank you for your contribution. Thank you for your contributions to hip hop and the DJ culture. So
thank you.
So with that being said, Cut, how can our listeners continue to follow you?
Oh yeah, man, it's real easy. My Facebook is JAY Cut Creator Philpott. It's Facebook, or same thing. Instagram is DJ Cut Creator 111. Instagram. It's just Cut Creator. You search it, it's all there.
Gotcha.
Yeah, man.
Okay, cool. What, Cut Creator, I want to thank you for allowing me to interview you for Vinyl Esquire. I want to thank you for taking the time and talk about, you know, your legendary history. You know what I mean? So you're now listening to Vinyl Esquire, and this is the legendary DJ Cut Creator.
Peace.
Hello, world. I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire, the podcast that delivers culture, truth, music. 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock.